Well, I really love this. Welcome again, namaskar aap sabhi ko, and this is a wonderful day, as I said. As we are here today to watch the grand finale of season 6 of Grey Matter Damps National Quiz. I have got a beautiful spread of teams here, and as it is customary, I'll start with team A, B, C, D, E. Wonderful people from different places representing different zones. This is the season 6 of Grey Matter Damps National Quiz. So definitely heartbeats are up, and we are going to make a memorable grand finale today. Without wasting any time further, I come to the introduction of team A, which represents the West Zone. Wonderful people here. The two team members who are sitting with me here right now is Hardik Nanavati from KJ Somaya Medical College, Mumbai. And along with him is Shalini S. Shah from St. GS Medical College, Mumbai. Welcome to both of you. Before I go to the next team, I would request you to kindly introduce yourselves.
Hello everyone, I am Hardik Nanavati from KJ Somaya Medical College,
Hello.
Mumbai.
Hello. Hello.
I am an intern right now.
Hello guys, I am Shalin Shah, KM Hospital and St. GS Medical College, Mumbai. I am final year MBBS.
Tell me something about your hobbies.
I like quizzing.
Wow.
And, I am a tabla player.
I do like quizzing and I play the guitar.
Wonderful, wonderful that is. And I wish you all the best. I welcome you formally in the season 6 grand finale of Grey Matter Damps National Quiz. Then I have a team B with me, team from the North Zone, the hot favorites, team from Ames, represented by Miss Ria Ahuja, welcome, and Umang Arora, representing North Zone both. Welcome both of you, kindly introduce yourselves.
Hi, I'm Ria Ahuja. I'm from Ames. I'm a final year student. I love playing table tennis.
Hello everyone, I'm Umang Arora. I'm from Ames, New Delhi, final year. And I like playing sports as well as quizzing. Thank you.
Welcome and thank you very much for your introduction. I come down to the team C, which is a wild card entry. Now this has become a trend. In every quiz you go, you find four teams, team A, B, C, D, or three teams. But this time, in Grey Matter, Damps National Quiz, we thought of doing something different. So we called somebody who was the second best in the country. Believe me, boys and girls, they have scored the second best marks apart from all these toppers, all these winners who are sitting and representing their respective zones. I welcome Siddharth S. from Maulanazad Medical College and Ankitesh, also from Maulanazad Medical College. Welcome both of you. Kindly introduce yourselves. Speak.
I am Ankitesh from Maulanazad Medical College, and my hobbies include playing cricket and reading books.
Wonderful that is.
I am Siddharth from Maulanazad Medical College, final year, and my hobbies are quizzes, sports and music.
Well, that's wonderful to know. I think a round of applause for all the people who are representing the wild card entry. Welcome formally in the season 6 grand finale. Then I come down to team D, team from the South Zone, represented by Ms. Sanjana. Welcome. She's from Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore. And along with her is Chidanand H.A. from Bangalore Medical College and Research Institute. I formally welcome both of you. Kindly introduce yourselves.
Hi everyone, I'm Sanjana Rai. I'm from KMC Mangalore. I'm an intern now. I like sketching and painting.
Hello everyone, this is Chidanand from Bangalore Medical College. I'm intern now. I love playing TT and cricket.
Wonderful that is. Welcome formally to this grand finale of season 6 DAMS Grey Matter National Quiz. But and last but not the least, I come down to team E, which is representing the east zone of the country. Two beautiful people here, Miss Samupriya Bhuyan from Guwahati Medical College, Assam, and Miss Alwaina Vedasiri from AIIMS, Patna. Welcome, kindly introduce yourselves.
Hello? Hello?
It's okay, yes.
Hello everyone, I am Sampriya Bhuya. I'm an intern of Guwahati Medical College and my hobbies are traveling and watching movies.
Wonderful that is.
Hello everyone, I'm Elvina Vedasiri from AIIMS, Patna. I love sports and dancing.
Welcome to both of you, and with that the introduction part is over. I wish you all the best, and before we start with the actual quizzing, if any team here wants to say or give any message to the other team, you are most welcome to say that now. Well, then may the best team win, and without any delay, I call upon the quiz master for the day, Dr. Sumer K. Sethi. Sir, you can take over the proceedings from here. Along with him, we have Dr. Deepthi Bhal, ma'am, welcome. Dr. Sachin Arora, Dr. Arvind, welcome, sir, and Dr. Siddharth. Thank you very much.
Okay, very good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. Now, the goal of today's session will be want to keep this quiz as a quiz as well as an education purpose, so that we will learn everything, we will learn something from every question. And what we have tried to do is, we have not created a trivia quiz that you see in your medical schools where you know you have some trivia. It is like pure medical education based quiz. We will have questions on each prof. There will be questions on physiology, anatomy, biochemistry, pathology, and there will be questions on junior final profs, clinical profs. And so each round will be hosted by a different person, and our goal will be to make sure that we revise the entire MBBS with you. Okay, so take quizzing as something where we are competing against each other, and we are also learning. Okay, we are also learning. Take it positively so that everybody learns at the end of the day. Okay, let's start with a quiz round one. And I'm sure you can guess by now, the round one is going to be first prof. Now
hello.
So I formally welcome on my own behalf as well all the teams, and I'm so happy to see the representation from entire country here. And we have people from Bangalore, Patna, Guwahati, Mumbai and Delhi also participating against each other. It's a good exercise. Let's again hope that the best team wins. Oh, it should be the best team who wins. So the rules, there will be total 6 rounds. We'll try to cover all the themes like basic sciences, preclinicals, paraclinicals. And we'll try to do questions in clockwise and anti-clockwise. Like suppose if I go clockwise in one round, I'll go anti-clockwise in the other, so that there's no undue advantage to anybody. You have to answer within the stipulated time. If you don't do that, you know, we will pass it to the next year. And as always, the decision of the quiz master should be final. And just in case you have too much debate to do, I have a good team of quiz masters sitting with me today. So you cannot debate, you know, the quality of people we have sitting outside. We have Siddharth, if you hear him on Facebook every day, he's teaching biostatistics, physics and PSM to people. Arvind, probably the best medicine teacher in the country today, and probably in Southeast Asia, but we don't compare all that. And Sachin is with us today for psychiatry and neurosciences, and Deepthi is going to talk about, and she's an excellent teacher, you know, I don't want to go home without, and this, she's going to talk about Austin Gaini as well. So this is the thing. So round one is going to be basics, anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, and we'll start with team A. Okay, rules are going to be, will be two questions. You will get one question and we'll come back to you with another question. Two questions in this round for per team, and if you answer correct, you get 20 marks. If you answer wrong, if you do not know, it will be passed. In the first go, there will be no negative marking, but in the pass, there will be a negative marking. In the pass, if you answer correctly, you get plus 10. If you answer incorrectly, you get minus 5. That is the basic rule of the quiz. So let me start with the, are you clear with the rules? Okay, simple rules. Let's start with the round one. Round one, the set one will be on physiology calculations. And this is the pattern that I have seen was followed in the JIPMER exam in the last year. Instead of asking theoretical question in the last year, they went on to calculations in physiology, and this is the round that we are do now. And I am sure it is going to catch the people by surprise, because this is we have never done this in any of the gray matters today. This is going to be calculation based. 20 points for a correct answer, plus 10 if you answer it in pass, minus 5 if for the wrong past answer. Time 1 because you have to calculate. So please have your papers and pens ready. And if these teams are not able to answer, I will pass on to the audience. And there are interesting prizes for the audience to be won. Okay, team A, on the screen now, team A. Find out the physiological dead space from the data provided. Tidal volume 500 ml. Alveolar air PCO2 40 millimeter mercury, expired air PCO2 20 millimeter mercury. I want the physiological dead space from you in 1 minute, and your time is on. Okay, audience, keep thinking. So you have to calculate the physiological dead space. Okay, on the basis of data given, you have a tidal volume with you, you have alveolar air PCO2 with you, you have expired air PCO2 with you. 40 mg, 40 millimeter mercury is the alveolar PCO2, and 20 millimeter mercury is the expired air PCO2. You have to tell me physiological dead space. And I'm giving you 1 minute for this kind of question, because you have to calculate here. Okay, team A, you want to say something?
250 ml.
They're saying 250 ml. What do you think, audience? What do you think? Correct. Correct. Full 20 marks to them. Correct. Very good. And this is the formula for the people who do not know. You can calculate physiological dead space if you take alveolar air PCO2, subtract expired air PCO2, divide by alveolar air PCO2 into tidal volume. So it is actually 40 minus 20 divided by 40 into 500, and we calculate 250 ml. Correctly calculated by team A. Very good. Okay. Very good. Team B. Are you ready? Team B, for your direct question now. Again, it's going to be a calculation based question. You will have to calculate and give me the answer here. Direct question for you, team B. Determine the oxygen content of the arterial blood from the data provided. Percentage saturation of arterial blood with oxygen, 90%. Percentage saturation of venous blood with oxygen, 70%. And hemoglobin, 10 gram per 100 ml. Okay. Utilize the data that you have with you, and you have to use this data to tell me the oxygen content of the arterial blood from the data provided. Okay. Your time is on. You have 1 minute. We're liberal in this round because you have to calculate. Okay? And I want you to know that these are the kind of questions sometimes they are asked in an exam called as JIPMER. In JIPMER, when they go to physiology, it is all about numerical physiology. But sometimes you don't study in that fashion in medical school, and that is where you get trapped. Okay? You have to tell me the oxygen content. Team B.
Is it around 12 ml?
They're saying 12. Okay?
12 to 12.5, roughly.
Okay, I'll give it to you. You're correct. It is actually 12.06 ml per 100 ml. I'll give it to you. Correct answer. This is how you actually calculate. Very, very good actually on your part. Each gram of hemoglobin can combine with 1.34 ml of oxygen. So the oxygen carrying capacity of this patient will be 10 into 1.34. That is 13.4 ml per 100 ml. Arterial saturation is 90%. So the oxygen content of the arterial blood will be 90 over 100 into 13.4 equal to 12.06. You have answered correctly, and this is, I think they deserve a big round of applause for that. Very good. So team C, are you ready for your direct question now? Team from MC, let's see. You have to calculate and tell us the answer on this. Calculate the cardiac output from the data given below. Oxygen content of the venous blood is 14 ml per 100 ml. Oxygen content of the systemic arterial blood, 19 ml per 100 ml. Heart rate, 70 per minute. Oxygen consumption per minute, 250 ml. Okay, you have to calculate the cardiac output from the data given below. Oxygen content of the venous blood is 14 ml per 100 ml. Oxygen content of the systemic arterial blood is 19 ml per 100 ml. Heart rate is 70 per minute. Oxygen consumption per minute is 250 ml. I want the cardiac output from you. Team C. Okay, we've kept the initial round very tough, and we have also introduced a special round this time on ECG, which is specially curated by Dr. Arvind, where you will learn how to look at ECG as well as quiz also. So we've tried to combine the two things here, and you will find a lot of questions in the exams from what Dr. Arvind is going to talk about, because he's a master of ECG teaching. So look forward to it. Okay, time is up. You want to give any answer or should we go ahead? They say 1.7 liter, and I'll have to pass it to other teams. I'm passing it to other teams. Team D. Team D. Now, always remember, when you answer it in pass, if you answer correct, you get plus 10. If you answer incorrect, minus 5 will be there. Team D.
3.5 liters per minute.
Team D. No. Okay. What are you saying?
3.5 liters.
Incorrect. Minus 5. Team E. Team E. No, they don't want to answer. Okay. Team A.
Around 5.6 liters per minute. 5.6 to 5.7 liters per minute.
Actually, I have a different answer with me. Okay, let's listen to Team B first.
5 liters.
5 liters. So they get the correct answer. They get plus 10. You get minus 5. Okay, you get minus 5. So please see how we calculate this. So the cardiac output is oxygen consumption divided by arteriovenous oxygen difference into 100. So it is 250 divided by 19 minus 14. That is 50 into 100. It is 5000 or 5 liter. 5000 ml per minute. Okay. So this is Team B gets plus 10. They get minus 5, they get minus 5, they get 0. Okay. Okay. Great. Okay. So that is where the round becomes more interesting. So now we have a direct question for Team D. Team D. Team from South. Are you ready for your direct question now? You have a minus mark already. Okay. So you have to be very careful now. Calculate the renal blood flow from the data given below. Concentration of PAH in urine is 14 milligram per milliliter. Of PAH in plasma 0.03 milligram per ml, rate of urine flow 1.5 ml per minute, hematocrit 50%. And notice I don't want the, look at what I'm saying, renal blood flow. I want renal blood flow. Notice the question very carefully. Concentration of PAH in urine is 14 milligram per ml. Concentration of PAH in plasma 0.03 milligram per ml. Rate of urine flow 1.5 ml per minute, hematocrit 50%. Okay, typical physiology question for you. Team D, you have time, don't worry, because this is the first set of questions where we are wanting to, you know, warm it up with calculations. So in physiology this year we have chosen calculations as the theme of physiology in this quiz. Team D, are you able to do it? Team D. Okay, and the time is running, but my team is counting the time. We have a very good set of people holding your scores and timers, so I'm sure you will be happy with their work by the end of the week. Okay, Team D, final 1 second for you to give your answer. Team D, she's still calculating something. What are you calculating? Tell me. Team D, he's saying pass. Team E, the question comes to you. Team E, they're saying pass. Team A,
1.4 liters per minute.
They're saying 1.4 liter per minute. Correct, they get plus 10 marks. Very good. Okay, now please see, the answer is 1400 ml per minute, that is the answer that I mean, and this is how you calculate. So you have the plasma clearance of pH is UV divided by P, which is 114 into 1.5 divided by 0.03. That was 700 ml per minute is the ERPF. There is the plasma clearance, but we wanted to know the blood flow. So then you took the hematocrit into consideration and you RPF into 100 divided by 100 minus hematocrit, and you could get 1400 ml, which is a very good answer by you. You get 10 marks for this, answering this in a past manner. Very good. So you can see for yourself that there are people who are able to ask questions, and this quiz is going to become interesting. So team E, direct question for you on the calculation. This is the final part of the calculation round here. Let's see how many of you can answer. Team E, calculate the blood volume from following data. Amount of dye injected, 4.5 milligram. Average concentration of the dye in plasma, 1.5 milligram per liter. Hematocrit value, 40%. I just want the blood volume from the data. The amount of dye that we have injected is 4.5 milligram. Average concentration of the dye in plasma, 1.5 milligram per liter. Hematocrit, 40%. Okay. Okay, team E, what do you think? Team E.
30 liters.
What are you saying?
30.
30 liters. Okay. Incorrect. I'll have to pass it to team A.
5 liters.
5 liters is the correct answer. Very good. So this is how we have actually calculated this. Amount of dye injected divided by average concentration in plasma. So 4.5 divided by 1.5, 3. Hematocrit is 40%. So plasma volume is 60%. So 3 into 100 by 60, we get 5 liters as the answer. Which they have answered correctly, they get 10 marks, they get 0. Okay. Okay. So this is the end of the first circle that we have done. I have extra question for the audience. So anybody,
sir,
from the audience,
sir,
who is able to answer this question here?
Sumer sir, I have a doubt.
Yes.
Sir, in the last question, actually it is not possible to calculate. So matlab, we don't know that the dye is only in the blood or not. So
you'll have to take some assumption here. Because otherwise, if you say that there is no answer, then there has to be answer. Because we have to take an assumption, and they have taken the assumption correctly. So next question is for the audience. And anybody in the audience who is able to answer this question correctly gets a prize from us. Okay. 7-year-old child having, male child having PCV 45%, RBC count 5 million per millimeter cube, hemoglobin 12 gram per 100 ml. What is the MCV value of this child? Okay. What is the MCV value of this child? Anybody from audience, raise your hand and answer, and you get a prize from us. 7-year-old male child is having PCV 45%, RBC count 5 million per millimeter cube, hemoglobin 12 gram per 100 ml. What is the MCV value of the child? Anybody from the audience? Anybody wants to answer? Anybody who's answering, raise your hand. 90. He gets a prize from us. Very good, raise your hand. 90 cubic micron is the answer. Very good. MCV is PCV divided by RBC count into 10, and 45 divided by 5 into 10, 90 cubic micron. So you will get a book by me called as Fire in the Belly, and a prize by DAMS on a special prize which is packed, which is the audience prize right now. We have varied audience prize, so different rounds will have different prizes for you. Now this is the end of the set one, and now in the same round, in the basic sciences round, now you will have anatomy and biochemistry questions. This round will be identify primarily, you will have to identify. The same scoring system will be applied, plus 20 for past 10 and minus 5 if you answer wrong in the past one. And the team round will go from E to A. So we'll start from E and go towards A now. Okay, team E, are you ready for your direct question now? Okay. Question number one for you is identify the X marked structure. You have to identify the X marked structure. Team E. Identify the X marked structure. Team E.
Recordal plate.
Okay, I'll have to pass it to team D. Team D.
Neural Neural
Correct, correct. They get full 10 marks for that. Pass marks. Yes, very good. These are the neurotest cells that we had marked with X. Now, team D. Team D, direct identify question for you. And this is simple questions to win marks, primarily based on anatomy and biochemistry in this round. This is a blood sample in case of. Okay, team D, this is a blood sample in case of. Very simple question. You see a blood sample and you have to tell me what is the case. I'll request the teams who have already answered to switch off the mics and switch it on in between so that the disturbance can be minimized. Team D, direct question for you. Should I pass it to other people?
Is it hyperlipidemia?
Can we give it to them? We have.
Yes.
We actually have a specific cause with us in the answer. Okay. Now I think you will be able to see better. So we have to pass it to the next team.
A beta lipoprotein. A beta lipoprotein.
We have to pass it to the next team to see what they are saying. Team C. Team C. Okay. Okay. Actually speaking, the answer that we are looking for was lipoprotein lipase deficiency, but we may, you know, discount this question here because, you know, there is a bit of controversy here that, you know, should we give. So we're discounting this question here. Okay. And we give you a fresh question again. Okay. We're discounting this question, but the answer that we are looking for was lipoprotein lipase deficiency. Okay. Now, team D. Okay. Direct question for you again. A 27-year-old male patient, BMI 34, has total cholesterol 450, triglycerides 610 milligram per deciliter, plantar xanthomas, has angioplasty done last year. Serum lipoprotein electrophoresis of the patient is shown to you. This patient is exhibiting a rare autosomal recessive disorder which generates mutation in which proteins? We want to know the protein now. Okay, team D. Direct question for you again, team D. Then we go to C. Okay, which protein?
LDL receptor.
Incorrect. Okay, Team C. Okay. Quick. Pass. Team B.
Pass.
Team A. Apolipoprotein beta 100. I think we cannot give it to you here. Okay, so audience, I think we are left with team E. Okay. Pass, audience. Okay, so the actual answer that we have is apolipoprotein E. Apolipoprotein E was the answer, and you had a patient with high cholesterol, high triglycerides, plantar xanthomas, angioplasty has been done in the past, and the electrophoresis is showing you beta and pre-beta area. This is apolipoprotein E was the answer that we are looking for. Okay, so now we have a direct question for team C. Direct question for you. Identify the marked muscle. Okay, team C. Identify the marked muscle.
Levator LPS.
LPS. Okay, full marks. Correct. This is levator palpebrae superioris. Correct. Very good. So they get full 20 marks for that. Team B. Direct question for you. Okay. Are you ready? Which identify the following muscle of mastication marked for you? Okay. So anatomy, we try to keep it very visual. You have to identify the muscle. Team B.
So medial pterygoid.
He says medial pterygoid. Correct. Full marks. Correct. Very good. This is medial pterygoid. And now we come to team A for the final question in this round. Identify the marked muscle. Identify the marked muscle. He says thylohyoid, and he's correct. Full marks for it. Again, very good. So this was the round one where we had anatomy, physiology, biochemistry as the primary theme of the quiz. Let me see if I have an audience question. I have an audience question with me. Identify the marked structure. You have to identify the marked structure which is marked by the red arrow. Let's see how many of you can answer this. Yes. Identify the marked structure.
Pontomedullary angle.
Okay. So the answer that I have is slightly different from that, but let's see if somebody is able to answer this.
Pontomedullary junction.
It is a junction, but the arrow is slightly ahead. Slightly ahead. What is ahead of this? Yes, somebody said. Okay, so cisterna pontis is the answer that we have with us. This is cisterna pontis. So unfortunately, we are not able to give to anybody. But I want to remind the students again that CP angle will never be seen on a midline sagittal section. CP angle is not on the midline. It is on the lateral side. If you say CP angle, that is a silly mistake to say. It is not CP angle. So the answer is cisterna pontis. Okay, so none of the person in the audience was able to get it here. So no prizes for the audience now. I come to the next. So the next round is going to be on. What is going to be the theme of the next round? Second prof. Second prof is going to be the theme of the next round. Let me load the round for you. So second prof is going to be the theme of the next round. Okay. And I already have the score with. For the teams already, team A is leading at 50, team B is at same score as 50, team C 20, team D 5, team E is yet to open the account. Okay, so this is the scores at the end of the round 1. That is very efficient. Okay, now round 2 is going to be paraclinical base. So primarily you will have questions on pathology, microbiology, forensic, pharmacology, and the questions will have marking scheme in a very unique manner. Okay, very very unique manner. We have tried to put marking scheme here. The first question that I'm going to say, each team I will ask 3 questions continuity. First question will have 10 marks, second question will have 20 marks, third question will have 30 marks. Okay, there will be different subjects. Each question you will have 20 seconds to answer, and it is passable. If you don't answer, it is going to be passed to the next team. Okay, any question which is not answered by the teams will go to the audience. Okay, team A, are you ready for your direct 3 questions?
Sir, is it?
If one question gets passed, then the second question comes back to the original.
Yes.
It will come. All of them are about the same topic.
Different topics. Each will have different topics. Different topics. Okay. All set. Team A, are you set for your first round? Okay. Team A, liver biopsy from a 45-year-old male patient with generalized skin pigmentation, diabetes mellitus, signs of cardiac dysfunction shows the following. Okay, the question, listen to me question again. What is the gene involved is present on which chromosome? I want to know the chromosome. Okay, look at this slide. There is skin pigmentation, diabetes mellitus, signs of cardiac dysfunction. I want to know on which chromosome is the gene involved present. Wrong. So before I show you the answer, let me pass to team B.
So HFE gene on chromosome 6.
6? What is 6? 6?
The chromosome the 6, yes.
6. I'm going to give it to you anyhow. 6P. 6P is the answer. They get 10 marks for the pass. 6P is the answer. Very good. Okay. So HFE gene present on chromosome 6P. And the liver biopsy was showing Prussian blue positive deposits of hemosiderin, and this is the patient with hemochromatosis. Okay, so we come back to team A again for the second question. Okay, okay, second question. Are you set for your second question now? This is for 20 marks. This is related to forensic. Okay, forensic question. Don't confuse it with any other subject. Forensic question. Identify what is seen here. Okay, identify what you are seeing. The clue is forensic, forensic medicine and toxicology. Don't just see for toxicology, forensic medicine and toxicology. Team B. Because there is something problem here. Not tell me, let's see. Team B. Team A. Team A. 20 marks to be won. 50,000 rupees if you win in the end. They don't want to take it. Do we call it something? Do you plumbism? I'm wrong. I'll have to pass it to team B. Team C, you want to tell me the name? Name of the phenomena, what you see here. Team C. Okay, you want to talk amongst yourself? Okay, after the quiz. Okay, team. Okay, team E. Team D. Team D. Team E.
Unjacketed bullet and lead deposits are being deposited in the lungs.
What do we call it? Okay, but they have actually given a very close answer, but I don't know if we can give it here or not because of the rules of the quiz. But this is lead snowstorm phenomena. Lead snowstorm phenomena. So the unjacketed bullet that has hit the body and then it's fragmented. But we wanted to know the phenomena because that is how the MCQs are. You may know it, but you need to know the name. What is the phenomena? So unfortunately, we are not giving it to any of the team here. Okay, lead snowstorm phenomena was the answer that I was looking for. Okay, 30 marks question now. 30 marks question for you. Direct team A. 25-year-old woman presents with one-day fever of 38 degrees Celsius, sore throat, dysphagia, greyish white papulovesicular lesion on the soft palate. Uvula, anterior pillars of the tonsil. What is the patient most likely infected with? I want to know the causative organism. Okay, 30 marks, microbiology. Team A. And you see something very typical on the
Syphilis, Treponema pallidum.
This is syphilis. Incorrect. Team B. Team B, you want to answer something or should we pass? Team B. They are not playing. Team C.
Staphylococcus.
Incorrect. Cut the marks. Incorrect. Team D. Team D. Team from South. Team, should I pass on? Team E, pass. So the answer that we are looking for is Coxsackie virus. And that was herpes gena that you saw on the soft palate. That is very typical of Coxsackie virus. And this was the first, I hope you can enjoy the round here. This round is on paraclinicals, but three questions per team, different subjects, 10, 20, 30 is the marking scheme. Make or break, you could have actually taken home 60 marks. But okay, now team B. Are you ready for your direct questions now? Team B. Ready? Okay. 35-year-old female, recurrent episodes of hemolytic anemia is being investigated. Flow cytometry is shown to you. Her blood cells, which are shown in red, show the following finding on flow cytometry. I want to know the curative management.
Eculizumab. Eculizumab or stem cell transplant.
Okay. What is the condition that you're suspecting?
PNH.
Okay. And okay, we might be able to give it to you because the answer that we have is PNH is correct and the stem cell transplantation is the answer that we have. So the key to this is that because this is how the, this is very good answer that you've given, that you have a flow cytometry where you can see both the CD55 and 59 are both low. And that is where both not there. So we think of PNH and PNH because PNH is a hematopoietic stem cell disorder. So we require hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, which is very good answer they have given, the 10 marks to them. Very good. Second question for you. Okay. Team B, second question for you. Identify the instrument. I want to know the name of the instrument. I will not give it to you if you don't name the instrument. And the theme is second prof instrument in front of you. You have to tell me what is it.
So we have no negative marking, right?
You don't have a negative mark.
It's a bone drill. Bone drill.
Bone drill. Okay. We have to pass it to our team. Next team. Team C, what do you think? They're saying pass is not pass. Okay, so team D. Team C. D. Okay, we have to go to them. D. E. A. Audience, anybody? What are we able to see here? Okay, and this is a device from a subject where you don't read devices, no? Anybody? Forensic medicine. And what are we able to look at? This is a brooch wrapper which is used for rifling. This is used in rifling. So we have tried to actually make subjects interesting by introducing some firearms in between. Okay, rifling. There will be firearm questions also for you, don't worry. Now third question for you. Team B, third question, direct question for you. 30 marks you can take home on this question. And you can see each question, the difficulty level will go up. Okay. Life cycle of this parasite consists of two stages. A cyst and a trophozyte. You have to tell me what is the most likely organism based on the image and the discussion that you see here. 30 marks you can take home. These 30 marks could translate into a good prize money.
So Giardia lamblia.
He says Giardia lamblia, correct. You get full 30 marks here. And you could see a leaf like flagella and the binucleate structure of this. So this was the trophozoite in the first image that you could identify. Very good. So they get full 30 marks for that. Okay. So now we come to team C. Team C, you will have now three questions for you. Are you ready for that? Okay. Three questions and 10 marks for the first, 20 for the next, 30 for the next. Okay. All set. 14-year-old female with abdominal distension, periodic diarrhea, weight loss, jejunal biopsy shown to you. What is the lymphoma associated with this condition? You see a jejunal biopsy. I want to know the lymphoma which is associated with this condition. A young patient with abdominal distension and diarrhea. What should I say? This is a T-cell lymphoma. Okay, I give it to you. Correct. Okay. It is enteropathy-associated T-cell lymphoma. And this was villus blunting celiac disease. And this is what the answer we were looking for. Okay. B. Okay. Okay. Second question for you. Second question. Direct question. Identify the range of this injury. Range. You can see. I hope you are able to understand the gunshot injury here. And you can see something. I want to know the range. Okay, I want to know the range in this gunshot injury. Okay, you want to say something or we move on? What do we call it? Range, we need the name. They said near, correct. Near range, correct. Correct, they get full 20 marks for that. Very good. Now the final question for you in this round. Final question. Chance to get 30 marks more home. 30 marks. Etiological agent shown in this photomicrograph is, you have to identify the organism that you see here. 30 marks. Incorrect. So I pass it to the next team. Team D. You want to answer? Team E. You want to say something? Team B. Audience. So this is what the negative marking does to you. This is my purpose of today's quiz. To tell you what happens when negative marking is introduced in your exam. Today in your exam now. Next year you will have negative marking. Okay. Now audience. No negative marking, only chocolates should be won. No, you don't want to play. Okay, so the answer is Chlorantius sinensis, and that was a leaf-like trematode that you could see here, and that is very typical of the organism. Okay. So we go for the direct questions now for Team D. Team D now. Team D. Are you all set for your three questions or paraclinicals? Okay. Team D. First question. A patient with cystic fibrosis is being investigated, and the following image is from the biopsy from the pancreatic duct. What is the histological thing that has happened in the pancreatic duct in this patient? Cystic fibrosis patient, you can see the biopsy and you can see the pancreatic duct. I want to know what is the histopathological finding in the pancreatic duct in this patient.
Metaplasia.
Can you qualify it a little bit further for me? What?
Squamous metaplasia.
Correct, correct. So there is vitamin A deficiency in cystic fibrosis that causes the columnar mucosa to go into squamous epithelium in this duct. Answer squamous metaplasia. Correct. Full 10 marks. Very good answer. Okay. Team D. Now you are warming up. Identify what you see in front of you. A very famous question from a very famous subject. I don't want to name the subject, otherwise you tell me. Okay. Identify what you see in front of you. 20 marks for this. You all have talked about all this in your vivas in second prof. Team D, you want to say something?
Is it ricochet bullet?
I don't think jacket. I don't think we can give it to you. My team doesn't allow me. Okay, let me pass it to the next team.
Dum-dum
bullet is correct. So you can see how the nose of the bullet is cut off. That is the dum-dum bullet. So when it hits the body, it mushrooms. The lead in it mushrooms. That is dum-dum bullet for you. And I'm so sorry you could not get it here. Okay. Now, Team D, third question for you. 30 marks is the marks that you can get in this quiz. Are you ready for that? Did you tell your friends that you're going to give them a party today already? Name the fungus shown to you. I can't give any more simpler question than this. For 30 marks, Team D. I hope you know entire India is watching you today.
Medicine for spaghetti and meatball.
Incorrect. And team, we go to Team E. Team E.
Ascomycetes.
I don't think we can give it to you. Incorrect. Team A.
Yeast, Candida albicans.
Correct, this is Candida albicans. Correct. And those are pseudo hyphae that actually were confusing you. Pseudo hyphae in the Candida albicans was confusing them. So they get marks for the passing question. Very good. Very good. So I hope you enjoy this round here, Team D. This was your direct questions. So Team E. Now the chance for you to make a mark on this quiz. Team E. Okay. You will have three questions. Paraclinicals team. Let's see answer. Team E. 80-year-old male has painless cervical lymphadenopathy. Occasional fatty cast in the urine. Biopsy of the lymph node is showing the following. I want to know the lesion in the kidney. I don't want to know the lymph node. The biopsy is of lymph node. But he has proteinuria, painless cervical lymphadenopathy, fatty cast occasionally in the urine. I want to know the possible lesion in the kidney. 8-year-old male.
Membrane nephropathy
is incorrect. And we go to Team A. Team A. They say pass.
MCD, minimal change disease.
Minimal change disease is correct. Correct. And you could see the Reed number cell, Hodgkin's lymphoma, association in a child. You had to think of minimal change disease. You got it wrong. They took advantage of your innocence here. They go to question number two. Identify the bullet used for firing. Identify the bullet used for firing here.
Incendiary.
Okay, I give it to you. Correct. This is incendiary bullet. Correct. 20 marks for you. 20 marks. Okay. Team E. Last question to get 30 marks on table. Team E. A 45-year-old woman, known HIV, AIDS, CD4 count 106, viral load 35,000 per ml, presents with painful growth on the side of the tongue. What is the most likely diagnosis? on the side of the tongue, patient with AIDS. It could not have been easier than this. Okay, you want to say something?
Candida.
Candida, incorrect. Team A. Team A.
Leukoplakia.
You want to add something to it?
Oral hairy leukoplakia.
Correct. They get the marks for passing. This is hairy leukoplakia is the answer that we're looking at. Look at the serrated margins. Look at the white lesions at the side of the tongue with serrations. Hairy leukoplakia is the answer. Correct. They get marks for passing. Okay. So this was the round two. We have an extra set of questions with us for the audience, and there are prizes to be won. In this round, what we have decided is there is a DAMS book on statistics that we have. This is a stats made simple book by DAMS team, and this is available as a prize in this question. Okay, a 25-year-old woman with recent onset anemia is being investigated. Her peripheral blood smear shows the following. What should be the next step in investigation? Okay. I want to know the next step in investigation in this patient, and you can see a blood smear in front of you. Okay, you just need to tell me the next test. Or anybody in the audience? Audience. Okay, so the answer is Coombs test, and we are not going to give it to team B here. Okay, we can give them a book. Okay, we can give them a book for their kindness. So you could see spherocytes, rounded cells with no pallor, that spherocyte with some Howell-Jolie bodies in between. The Coombs test was the next step to be done. Audience, next question for you in the audience is going to be this. Identify the structure between the bacteria. Raise your hand and win a prize. Anybody raise your hand and answer. Or orange, girl in front. Yes, yes, please. Conjugation tube is the correct answer. Who has answered? Yes. So he is getting a prize from us. Ayush, give him a prize. Okay. So at the end of this round, so now we have two rounds that we have done now, which were on pre-clinicals and paraclinical themes. In the next round, which is going to be on the theme that you do in junior finals. So what subjects do we have in junior finals? PSM and Ophthalmology ENT. So in this, to conduct this round, I will invite Dr. Siddharth to, you know, enlighten us with his knowledge on PSM, and as well as help us. I'll also ask my team to give us the score if we already have them. And I would request the audience to show some energy, as people all over India are watching you, and they believe that India is in Delhi is supposed to be the most energetic audience in the country. So can we hear from you for yourself? Who is the best audience in the country? Delhi. Yes.
Okay, so we here come to the round three. This is one round where I would like to justify two important things. The first one is the topic PSM. Okay, just a second. So this is the round three where I would like to just highlight two important things, especially in the subject of PSM. First, earlier the questions were more theoretical. Now it is calculation based and conceptual. And second, the new park is actually the old park, which you will realize in just a couple of minutes when you will see the data in India currently changes very, very rapidly. Now in this particular set of questions, we will have three questions for every team. The first question is for 75 seconds when you get 25 marks. If you do not answer, we skip the question, but you do not have a chance to answer it again. You do not have a chance. Question number two, 25 seconds, 5 marks. Question number three, 50 seconds, 20 marks, but if you ask for a hint, the marks get reduced to 10. Yes, so a total of 150 seconds per team per set of questions. This round is not a round which you can pass on, but others, please look into this, because you will understand there are some important tricks to be learned in this subject and also in the clinical subjects from ophtha and ENT. Okay, so we start with team A. Team A, we start with you. The first question.
Sir, the last round also started from team A, so.
So you don't want to take the first shot?
No.
It's fine.
Sir, but so the next possible round should be in reverse order. This is a non-possible round, so.
Let's start with A only. Yep. Okay. Please calculate the parameter of association for this 2x2 table. The time starts now, 75 seconds. Parameter of association. First identify the study design and then progress. Wrong. Next question. 30 seconds.
50 years.
Great. Absolutely correct. Next question. So this is a clinical question. Do you want a hint to this? Over here, you can see a 50-year-old patient who has come over here with a diminution of vision. Okay? And on the cornea, you are getting some opacities. Would you like a hint for this? 50 seconds for this question.
Hint.
Okay. Two hints for you, but the score goes down by 10. Yes? Okay. So it's a stromal dystrophy. Okay? And on histopathology, you are basically seeing a colloidal iron positive, and it's an autosomal recessive inheritance.
Schneider's corneal dystrophy.
Okay, any other name of this dystrophy? Because there are three variants to it, and it's a very specific one. That's the reason I want that variant. Okay, fine. So, three questions, 5 marks to the team A. Now, let us see what were the answers to these. Okay. So, the first question. This is a case control study. And this is evident if you see the case and control. Now, this table has basically been jumbled up where the questionnaire has basically transferred the exposed and the non-exposed columns. If you see it carefully, actually you have to rearrange the 2x2 table and you would have got the answer as 2. Even if you would have not done it, you would have got the answer 2 only. So basically in a case control study, 2x2 table is not a big issue. You can either way take it because the formula is a cross product, that is AD by BC. Yes? So the answer would have been 2, not the option 2, the value 2, that is the option A. This, excellent, 50 years. Now this is as per the SRS report, which was just released 5 days back on the 27th of September. The population doubling time is calculated as 70 by the annual growth rate. The annual growth rate is basically calculated by taking the difference between the crude birth rate and the crude death rate, and we divide it by 10. And the values are there. If you would have calculated exactly, India is now going to have population doubling time of 50 years. So we are actually progressing in the population control forum. Yes? Now this question, basically you were correct. It was a stromal dystrophy. Yes? But there are three variants to it, and the variant over here, which I was looking over here, is the one which is autosomal recessive, that is the macular variant. Yes? Fine. So with this, we come to the end for the team A. Team B, ready? Three questions. I hope you understand. The first question is a calculation based question with 75 seconds time. Yes? Okay, please calculate it. Basically, in this question, in the series, an additional 5 has been added by mistake. And the examiner wants you to understand how the mean, median, and mode will change in this particular setting. This was a similar repeated question in the AIIMS and the NEET PG exam as well. Probably a school kid can also do it very easily. It's a very basic maths. 75 seconds. Kind request to all students preparing PG exams, do not solve questions in the third dimension, that is air. please use a copy and a pen to solve it. About a basic mistake made by students in the exams. Use a pen and paper to solve such questions. Seconds. Okay, 10 is left. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5.
A. Option A.
Okay, so you say the median and the mode remain same. Mean is excellent. Absolutely the correct answer. Yes? So you get plus 25 for this. Next question. 30 seconds. Next question. 30 seconds. The IMR of India currently. Wrong. Third question, you me. Have to...
Can you please close the light, sir? You can't see.
We will wait for that time. The current IMR is 34 now. You just made it with a single point, but it makes a huge difference. Yes? Again from SRS, latest data launched in this last week of September. Yes? Question number 3, 20 question. Please read the fundus. You have to identify the stage of this disease, which... A small child with a birth weight of 1.5 kg will suffer. You need to name the stage, not the disease.
So stage 2, ROP.
Excellent. How did you know it's stage 2?
Ridge formation has been.
Excellent. So because of the ridge formation, it is stage 2 over here. Okay. There are 4 or 5 stages of this. Different books have mentioned different stages. If you see, the stage 1 is basically the line of demarcation. Stage 2, there is a ridge. Stage 3, there is a fibrovascular tissue leading to neovascularization. Stage 4, there is a tractional retinal detachment, whereas stage 5, there is total retinal detachment. So you were able to get 2 major questions correct. So you get a score of plus 45. Excellent. Yes? Team 3, get ready because they have taken a significant lead. Yes? First question, 75 seconds. The question is here. You have to calculate the secondary attack rate for this question. A very, very common question appearing in the PT exams, and you should be fundamentally clear with this question. There are 6 members in this family. The disease we are talking about is swine flu. Only one is immunized. Only one child is immunized. Secondary attack rate. Only 2 tricks which can come in this question. ₹50 of your time is gone. Wrong. Next question. ORS. We only knew this ORS ka ghol, but now there's a new ORS. This is a method to take online appointments in AIMS and PGI and MIMC. What is this? What is the full form of this? Full form. It's only online registration. ORS. There are 3 letters.
Server.
Wrong. Third question. Read this and tell me that a 30-year-old male patient has actually come to your OPD with history of stress. There's a huge business loss. What do you think is the disease? Would you like a hint? Excellent. Excellent. Yes. So basically you got the third question right. And this is only the third question right. So you get a plus 20. Okay. Now let us see. The first question was on secondary attack rate. There are 6 members in this family. And it is swine flu. So even the adult parents are also susceptible. One is immunized. Yes. There are 2 secondary cases over here. The number of susceptibles generally we counted as 5, but since this is a secondary attack rate, the basic trick is you have to exclude the primary case. So it would have been 2/4 and your answer would have been 50%. Please be very careful for such a question.
Sir, the child is immunized till date, but we don't think he should be immunized for swine flu. It's not part of the program, any program.
Okay, now let me clarify over here. Basically, we are talking about here and we are talking in context of swine flu. That's the reason we assume that the child is immunized for this. Okay? Now, ORS, Online Registration System. Yes? Okay, let's not fight it out. Yes, we can have a wrestling match later. Okay? Now, this is a very good initiative where you can even book the super speciality appointments at the central institutes. Currently, it is functional. No, that's what I asked, because the word which came out was online registration only.
Then we told online registration system, we told we want the full form, then we...
Okay. Okay. We'll give you that additional 5 marks. Okay, fine. No issues. This one, excellent answer. Central serous retinopathy, typically seen in males on a bit of stress. Basically, you have to counsel the patient and tell 6 months your vision will be back. Yes? Okay. Team 4. First question, 75 seconds. Here it comes. You have to calculate the crude birth rate for the data for a PHC. Over here, the age-specific fertility rate is given. So you have to calculate the crude birth rate over here. This is now a bread and butter question for the NEET PG exam. Mandatory to come every year. Simple additions and some multiplication, your job is done. Three age groups have been given. Yes, 75% time is gone, 25% left. Wrong. Next question, 30 seconds for this. Excellent. Question number 3. You have to look into this image and tell me what is this condition. Basically, the patient had come to you with a discharge from the eye and the patient had been given a very common antibiotic. Yes, on the next following visit, the particular image was obtained. What do you think must be the condition, or which antibiotic are we talking about over here? Very common antibiotic with prescribe. Like a hint? Would you like a hint? Okay, so two hints for you. So this is basically a reaction for a common topical antibiotic. The condition is reversible and just reverses by itself once you stop the therapy. Earlier the drug of choice for typhoid as well. Okay, so the time is gone. Yes, the time is already over. So basically it was a ciprofloxacin induced corneal deposits, very very commonly seen in the ophtho OPD. Okay, so the quiz masters are giving you this question. You have been awarded for this question. So two questions, you score 25. Yes, 20 plus 5 is 25. Now the only question which you had made mistake, so 15. So the only question where you missed was this. Yes, now in this question to basically add the age specific fertility rates and multiply it by the interval in each age groups. Yes, so basically the interval in each age group is 10 years. Now this is a very routine formula where we calculate the crude birth rate as 8 into total fertility plus 1. If you would have done it, you would have easily got a 37.2. the only trick in this question is how much is the interval. Generally students make a difference and multiply it by 9. So you are not supposed to multiply by 9, you are supposed to multiply by 10. Why? Because it is 15 to 24, so you include both the age groups. Yes? Fine? Okay. So now let's come to the next team, team 5. Yes? 3 questions for you. The first question is this, 75 seconds. Excellent common sense question. You should not ask me how many are the number of cigarettes in a pack. Patient comes to your OPD, gives a history of smoking, 6 years of smoking are there, and there's a sequence which is given. Yes, you have to calculate the mean, median, and mode for this question. even if you are not a smoker, you can solve it. Do not rely on your mug up values. Please open your eyes. Excellent common sense based question thrown to you in your recent PG exams as well. ₹50 time is gone, I guess. Okay, more than that. Okay.
Any guesses?
B for Bombay? Okay, wrong. We'll come to it. Question 2. You are given 30 seconds for this.
Five months.
Wrong.
5 years.
Wrong. Question number 3. Here you have to answer on the PARC test. Okay. The patient is presented with a left sided hyperphoria. Increased hyperphoria and looking at the right side. What do you think is the muscle involved? You can take a hint as well. Even anatomy, basic anatomy can help you to answer this. Do you want a hint?
Left superior oblique.
Absolutely correct. Yes? Very good. So basically you get 20 score for this round. Okay? You missed a very easy question which you had answered correctly probably on the third row. That is less than 15 years is the measles and rubella campaign now. Okay? In India currently it is 9 months to less than 15 years. Yes? Earlier it was 9 months to less than 10 years. Now it has been recently revised. This question purely based on common sense where you missed one very important trick. Over here they had mentioned the total number of cigarettes is odd number. Yes, and then you should have proceeded and you would have got an answer if you would have calculated properly using a common sense as the option C. Yes, fine. Okay, so with this we come to the end of the round for all the teams. Some for the audience. Yes, a very common question. Please calculate the 95% confidence interval for this question. Please go ahead to calculate this. A bread and butter question. Very common question coming in an exam. Just one trick. Calculate the standard error. Yes, please. Option A. Okay, please explain the calculation first.
comes up to 95%. So like we are being asked to 95% of the population, therefore.
Absolutely wrong. You have made a basic error. Whenever we talk about confidence and your population, you have to calculate the standard error. If you would have calculated the standard error, then the standard error is calculated as SD by root over N. Your answer would have come as 24 to 26. A very, very common question appearing in your exams, which we generally make an error in. Yes. Next question for the audience. A basic true or false question. Basic true or false question. Do we modify the pediatric TB management if there is a change in weight of the child? Okay, anybody please raise your hand. Okay, yes ma'am. Okay, so you say we modify it?
We don't modify it.
Okay, it's wrong. For the pediatric age group, we do modify as per the change of the weight. In the adults, there's no modification even if there is a change in weight. Yes, generally we know it for adults. For pediatric age groups, there is always a confusion. Yes? Okay. So you can see the weight bands are over here. This is as per the new RNTCP guidelines. Okay? Third question. basically you can see over here, there is an image which has been put up for a 60-year-old lady, and she was having a painful joints. Okay, on clinical examination, the patient is presenting with respiratory difficulties. Hello? And renal amyloidosis. Yes, what do you think is the glittering stuff over here? What substance do you think is this glittering stuff? Anybody? What substance do you think? Anybody? Okay, so we would not give an answer to this. A common substance which every girl in this world would like to have. Yes, one is diamond, the other is?
Iron.
Nobody would like to have it, man. Gold. Yes, this is basically used for treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, okay, and which gets deposited in the eye and presents typically with this. Yes, so with this we come to the end of round 3. Okay, the basic motto for this round was to make you realize PSM requires bit of calculation, and second, it's all about the new data. Ophtha is about images. Fine. So now, by the time we have score, I'd like to invite Deepti ma'am for round 4. Okay, so get set for the round 4 over here. Okay,
and I think we should have this course before the PSM. And a special mention of our scorers, Mr. Raket and Mr. Mahesh, they're doing a wonderful job here. And the timekeepers, wonderful girls, Ms. Kanika and Ms. Komal.
Right. Hello, everyone. So at the end of round 3, team A is at 75. Team B is going to be at 155. Great. Team C is at 70. And team D is at 30. Yes. And team E is at 40. Right. So team B is leading. Back up, everyone else. Right. We're going to start with the round 4. Right, so round 4 is going to be clinical vignettes for all of you. So I think me, Dr. Sameer, as well as Dr. Arvind are going to together host the round for you, right? Because we have clinical vignettes from all subjects. And this is how the marking scheme goes. So we're going to ask 2 questions per team. And if you answer it correct, you're going to get plus 20. We have no negative marking for it. And yes, but we do have marking, negative marking if we pass on the question. So if you do it correct as a pass on question, you get plus 10. While minus 5 if you do it wrong as a pass on question. Although we did think of starting from A to E, but I think we'll start the other way around. So we're going to start from team E first and then go in the anti-clockwise first. And for the next 5 questions, we'll go in the clockwise direction, right? And are you all ready for it? So we're going to have the first question for you on screen now. A 31-year-old female has had a normal delivery 3 months ago. She now presents with persistent uterine bleeding and dyspnea. Her chest x-ray shows the following picture, and on colposcopic examination, a lesion is observed in the vagina in the suburethral region, which bleeds easily on touch. What is your diagnosis? Team E, this is a question for you, and you have 20 seconds to answer that question, please. Very, very characteristic. I will not be able to give that to you. This is not a PSTT. And there is a very gross thing which this one shows which is not seen in PSTT. What is this? Anybody from the audience?
Question will pass.
Oh, okay. So let's thank you, Umang, for reminding me the rule. Right, question passes on to team D. We'll go in the anti-clockwise. Yes, we give it to them. The answer is going to be choriocarcinoma. Absolutely right. And as I said, it's grossly different. Why is it different? This particular chest x-ray as well as the gross or colposcopic image shows you metastasis. And PSTT is classically non-metastatizing, right? So choriocarcinoma is the GTN which metastatizes. PSTT 70% of times is a non-metastatizing neoplasia, right? So I couldn't give it to you. Very good, Team D. We have the next question for Team D itself. Are you ready? Right, so that was the answer for this one. All right. The following three radiograms are of an 80-year-old boy. Which condition is he suffering from? And you have exactly 20 seconds to answer the question.
They say NF2 is correct. Correct, very good. So the correct answer is NF2 because you can see bilateral vestibular schwannomas, you can see ependymoma, and you can see a meningioma with the sign, and you can see bilateral vestibular schwannoma showing the ice cream cone appearance at the CP angle. Correct, they get full marks.
Right. So we have the question 3 now for Team C. Team C, a young female is diagnosed with paraganglioma and a pulmonary chondroma. She undergoes endoscopic examination of stomach, and following are the endoscopic findings and corresponding histopath findings. Yes. Very good. Yes, they're absolutely right.
Ma'am, that's not the
answer. And, okay. Yes, we still give it to you. Yes, so okay. So the diagnosis is GIST, that's absolutely right. And the Carney's triad, do you want to elaborate on it? What is the third point in the Carney's triad? It is GIST, right? So they're absolutely right. And what do you see here? You see these spindle cells, right? Okay, so we have the next question for Team B. Team B, are you ready? So this was just, right. A 40-year-old food blogger presented to the casualty with an urticarial rash, edema of lids, face, and dyspnea. His symptoms subsided on supportive treatment. 5 weeks following this episode, the patient returned with complaints of dyspnea and hemoptysis. He was diagnosed a case of congestive cardiac failure, and unfortunately he succumbed within a week. This is a muscle biopsy from the patient. What is the picture showing? Team B, you have 20 seconds.
Ma'am, trichinella spiralis.
All right, absolutely correct. So this is trichinella larvae in the muscle, right? And they're absolutely right. So we're going to, what is it also called as? Porkworm. Right, it's called as the pork worm. Right, so we have the next question for Team A. Team A, are you ready? Identify the congenital anomaly shown in this chest X-ray. And you have 20 seconds. Yes, Team A.
Egon side appearance.
No, that's incorrect. That's incorrect. So the question goes on to Team E. Team E, that's a pass on question. Remember, you have a negative marking.
They're saying pass. Okay, so we pass on to the next team. Team D.
Cleidocranial dysplasia.
They're saying cleidocranial dysplasia. Correct. They get correct. So always remember, never forget to look at the bones, look at a chest X-ray. If you see the clavicle in this patient are absent. So there are no clavicles. So the answer is cleidocranial dysplasia. This is the chest X-ray finding of cleidocranial dysplasia is the correct answer.
Right. So since we are done with the first five questions, we are going to go in the clockwise direction now. So it's going to be Team A again. Are you ready, Team A? All right. A middle-aged man reported to the OPD with a history of skin and oral lesions. Cytopathology and direct immunofluorescence of the skin sample reveal the following findings. What is your diagnosis? Absolutely correct. They're absolutely right. The answer is pemphigus vulgaris. And although just for the academic purpose, what smear do you see here? Yes, you're right.
The histopath is smear, and that is
absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. So this is the Zank smear, and we use the GM sustain for it. Do you also know what cells are you seeing here? So these are the classic acantholytic cells that you see here with a very large nucleus and a very narrow rim-like cytoplasm, right? So acantholytic cells. Where else do you see the acantholytic cells? Anybody from the audience, and it's a DD, herpes, okay? So you also see them in the herpes, and how do you differentiate their cancellitic cells of the two? These are mononuclear, while those are multinuclear, right? So these are mononuclear, all right. The next question is going to be for Team B. Team B, are you ready? All right. A 35-year-old female traveler who just came back from Goa after a month's vacation. Wow, lucky female. Do we have those kind of vacations in medicine? No, okay. So she had a 1 month vacation in Goa, presented to the OPD with the following lesions. What is the diagnosis? What is the diagnosis? Team B?
Otitis externa.
No, that is incorrect. Question passed on to Team C. Do you want to give it a try? But remember, there's negative marking as well. No, we are asking what is the diagnosis. Pass. You want to give it a try, Team C. Pass. Team D. Do you want to give it a try? Remember, +10 if you get it correct, but -5 if you get it wrong. Team D? Sorry?
Swimmers here.
No, I'm sorry. So a -5 for them. Team E, do you want to give it a try or no? Team E? No? Pass? All right. Team A?
Aspergillus.
No, I'm sorry. That is incorrect. So a -5. Anybody from the audience? Anybody from the audience? All right, so this is discoid lupus erythematosus, DLE. And what exactly do you see here? Do you know? You're seeing erythematous plaques here, and the characteristic thing about the plaque is the scaling on it. And earlobe is a very, very characteristic site. What else is written in the MCQ which gives you a very, very good hint about DLE? Because it is seen in sun-exposed areas. So, a trip to Goa, right? So I did say she was lucky, but she turns out to be unlucky in the end. But yes, so very, very characteristic of sun-exposed areas. Scalp is the other common site for DLE, but this ear is a very, very common site, right? And it's an autoimmune disease, and as I said, it is triggered by sun, right? So this is DLE. So now it is the question for Team C, right? And I think we'll have Dr. Arvind for the next few questions.
Clinical history of 30-year-old male presents to physician with a complaint of progressive weakness in his hands and feet. Patient states that the symptoms, they are slowly progressive over the past few months. Initially, he was unable to manipulate small objects such as picking up a coin or buttoning his shirt. Now complained of difficulty in grasping a gallon of milk and notices twitching in the muscles. He often trips while walking because he feels he can't lift his toes up and lacks coordination. In addition, he says that the muscles in his leg, occasionally there are cramps and spasms. What is the diagnosis? So, do you want hint? Huh? Time is over. So, this was for Team C. Okay. So, we'll pass it on. Team myotonic. Myotonic dystrophy. Myotonic dystrophy. Do you get cramps in myotonic dystrophy? No. You will not get. Huh. So, I'll pass it on to Team D. No. Team E. No. Team A. Team B. Okay. So, this is a typical case of, first, if you can see, this is a case of lower motor neuron lesion. This is a lower motor neuron lesion. There is history of fasciculations. Twitching means fasciculations, and patient is occasionally having cramps and spasm. So it could be either a peripheral neuropathy or a motor neuron disease. With the history of progressive over months and mainly the distal weakness, this goes in favor of some motor neuron disease. And as you can see, the sensory symptoms are absent. So it is not of a neuropathy, it is more of a motor neuron disease. It could be ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. So it is a motor neuron disease. So no marks. Okay, ALS. Now team D. Okay, seventy-year-old man with a history of rheumatoid arthritis comes to the physician complaining of weakness one day after a motor vehicle accident. Physical examination reveals intact sensations, strength in the lower extremities, but weakness in the upper extremities bilaterally. The patient is able to move his arms parallel to the ground, but is unable to lift his arms, forearm or hands against the gravity. Strength is 2/5. CT scan of the cervical spine rules out fractures. MRI demonstrate traumatic C6 disc herniation, and there is a edema within the cervical cord in that area. So what is the most likely diagnosis for this case? History is very important. There is a weakness of upper extremities, lower extremities are spared. So what is the diagnosis? Okay, so there is no answer from team D, so I will pass it to team E. Team E. No. Okay, team A. Team B, Team C. I will give you, yes, you have given me the etiology, but what exactly is the syndrome? Because syringomyelia MRI does not demonstrate the syringomyelia. It is, what is that syndrome? Syringomyelia is one of the etiology of that syndrome. Yes, very good, very good. This is central canal syndrome. Very, very nice. Yeah, so,
the USMLE team has contributed, and you can see the clinical touch and how they.
Okay. Yeah. So the explanation is there is something in the central canal which is compressing the if you can see the pyramidal fibers in the spinal cord, internal pyramidal fiber are the cervical upper limb and the outermost is the sacral one. So it is compressing the cervical one, that is the upper limb, it is compressing and it is sparing the lower limbs. And there is one more typical feature of this central canal, dissociative sensory loss. Dissociative sensory loss means it will compress the spinothalamic tract, that is pain temperature will go, and it will spare the posterior fibers, that is the position sense vibration will intact. So dissociative sensory loss is again a characteristic feature of central canal. So one of central canal syndrome, one of the causes trauma, other is the syringomyelia, and it can be tumors also. So yes, answer is central canal syndrome. Now coming to the next question, and this is for team E. So 50-year-old man presents to his physician complaining of worsening dyspnea on exertion, orthopnea and PND. So typical feature of CHF, his medical condition is notable for anterior myocardial infarction 15 months back. Holosystolic murmur is audible at the apex with a diastolic rumble. ECG demonstrate left ventricle hypertrophy and deep broad Q waves, which is expected because of the old MI. Echocardiography shows depressed, reduced ejection fraction and thinning of left ventricle walls. What is the most likely diagnosis? Dilated cardiomyopathy, exactly on time. Yes, it is a case of dilated cardiomyopathy. Main feature is history of myocardial infarction, which has depressed the myocyte contractions. Ejection fraction is depressed. There is dilatation, thinning of the walls. So it is a typical case of a dilated cardiomyopathy with low ejection fraction. So with this, we finish with the round of clinical subjects. So next round.
So now I'll invite Dr. Sachin to take us to the next round. Next round is going to be a round on neurosciences, primarily on neurosciences.
Ankitesh.
Hello. Yes. Thank you, sir. So after the end of round 4, we are going to start round number 5. As sir has introduced about round number 5, the theme of round number 5 is it's a theme round. We are focusing mainly on neurosciences. So about the rules of this round are, so we call it as power punch theme round, turn the counters, because this round has certain special rules. The special rules are, each team can score a maximum of 75 marks and each team will be allowed to choose the topic of their choice from the available list of 5 topics, whatever topic you choose. But this time I am changing one of the rules here. The lowest scoring team till round 4 will be given the first choice. Okay, so that rule, team which is scoring lowest till now will be given as the first choice to choose, and whatever you choose, the same topic, subtopic of neurosciences, you'll be given 5 questions, each question in increasing order of severity, 5, 10, 15, 20 and 25 marks, and there's no negative marking, no passing in this round. So in order to choose the topic, we'll have scores at the end of round 4. Are you scores?
Sir, last ke baad second last, third last,
yes. 10 seconds per question. So these are the 5 teams. So based on the scores at the end of round 4, I'm not announcing the scores, but the team E would be given the first choice to choose. You can choose one topic out of these 5, and whatever topic you choose, you will be given 5 questions on that. So which topic would you like to choose? Which subject rather? Come on, decide. Whatever you feel confident at.
Neuroanatomy.
Okay, neuroanatomy. So neuroanatomy questions for you are, first question, cerebromedullary cistern is also known as, cerebromedullary cistern is also known as, other name of cerebromedullary cistern. No negative marking, you can answer. Yes, that can be given to you. Plus 5 marks. Second question. Posterior external arcuate fibers are formed by which tract? Posterior external arcuate fibers are formed by which tract? Name of the tract. Posterior external arcuate fibers are formed by which tract? Okay, next question for you. Which center is located in or near the area posterior?
Vomiting center.
Yes, that can be given to you. 15 marks for this. Plus 15. Fourth question. Which bundle of fibers consists of 3 type of white fibers? All 3 types. Projection fibers, commissural fibers and association fiber. Which bundle of fibers consists of all 3 types of
white fiber. This is for 20 marks. Which part? Okay, time up. Last question for you. It's for 25 marks. H field of Borel is present medial to which nucleus? 25 marks. Okay, so time up for this one. So they get two correct answers, 5 and 50, 20 marks. Anybody who would like to answer the last question? H field of Borel is present medial to which nucleus? New question. So the answers in neuroanatomy, first cisterna magna, cuneo cerebellar tract, third true vomiting center or chemoreceptor trigger zone. Fornix has all three fibers. Okay? And the last answer is zona increase. So this was neuroanatomy for you. So the next team.
Not internal capsule.
No. Zona increta is a better answer. Okay, so you ask. Now, next team which gets a choice is team D. Which would you like to choose out of remaining four? Psychiatry, neuromedicine, neurophysiology or neuropharmacology? The theme of this round is Niemann's entrance pattern. We have a Niemann's entrance exam which is for MD psychiatry, DM neurology, MCS neurosurgery courses, where we have basic theme of neurosciences. Which subject would you like to choose? Psychiatry, okay, very good. So, psychiatry questions for you. First question, bad trip is the most common adverse effect of which drug? Name the drug. Substance. I cannot give it to you, I said most common. Which bacterial infection is linked to OCD? Which bacteria? You just name the bacteria. No need to tell me the group, just the bacteria name. Yes? I cannot give it to you. P300 evoked potential response is related to which psychiatric disease? Name of the disease. This question, the scoring depends on the subject you choose. P300 evoked potential response is related to which psychiatric disease? Okay, next question. Who gave the concept of epigenetic principles to psychiatry? Name anything. Name any person you know in psychiatry. Which person you know in psychiatry? Anyone? I expected this answer only. I'm incorrect. Calculate IQ of a student, 18-year-old, whose mental age is 12. Come on. You have performed so big calculation. This is the easiest one you can. IQ of a student, 18-year-old, whose mental age is 12. It's something like a first year MBBS student, 18 years old. Mental age is 12. Come on, IQ. What's your answer? I'm afraid it's the wrong answer. Anybody who can answer the IQ?
80. 80.
How?
Ek limit or the lower
limit. What is the limit?
15.
Yes. I cannot give it to you for any answer. Answers in psychiatry are LSD. Bad trip, most common adverse effect of LSD. Streptococci is linked to OCD. Schizophrenia, P300 evoked potential. Evoked potential. Okay. Eric Erickson gave epigenetic principle. And IQ calculation is mental age upon chronological age into 100, where chronological age maximum is 15. Okay. Any IQ calculation, chronological age maximum is 15. So the next team to which I give you the choice from the remaining subjects is team A. What would you like to choose? You have neuromedicine, neurophysiology, neuropharmacology.
Neuromedicine.
Okay. So these are the neuromedicine questions for you. First question, suspended sensory loss is seen in. Name the disease. Say anything, no negative marking for you. Yes, correct answer. That can be given to you. Name the gene which decreases the risk of Alzheimer's dementia. Not increases. Decreases. Say anything, no negative marking for you. Come on.
LRRK2.
No. Name the diagnostic criteria of Miller-Fisher syndrome. Name of the criteria. Everything is from Harrison. Nothing beyond that. Name of the criteria. These are those specific questions which are only in Harrison. Name of the criteria. Triad, everybody knows. No? Okay.
most common form of inherited autosomal dominant ataxia? This is a very famous question of ataxia. Frederick ataxia. I said autosomal dominant. Okay, I cannot give it to you. Name the pontine nucleus for maturation reflex. It's a 25 mark question. I cannot give it to you. The correct answers are, you said syringomyelia, that's correct, 5 marks. ApoE2 is the gene, decreases the risk. Brighton criteria, Miller-Fisher syndrome. And it is spinocerebellar ataxia type 3, I said autosomal dominant, Mercado-Joseph disease. And last is Barrington nucleus. So the next choice is for team C. And the subjects for you left are neurophysiology, neuropharmacology. These are the questions for you on neuropharmacology. Name the new antidepressant drug which has an action on melatonin receptors. I said antidepressant drug. I cannot give it to you. Which antipsychotic is useful in the treatment of tardive dyskinesia? Most of the antipsychotic cause tardive dyskinesia. Which is useful in the treatment of tardive dyskinesia? It's a recent PG entrance exam question. Only antipsychotic. I cannot give it to you. Name the anti-Parkinsonian agent available as a transdermal patch. Very famous. Anti-Parkinsonian agent. Transdermal patch. Guess? That can be given to you. 15 marks. Name any one new drug in pipeline targeting amyloid plaques in Alzheimer's disease.
Trimiprosate.
Targeting amyloid plaque. I can give you a hint. It's a monoclonal antibody. Any monoclonal antibody, three.
Sir, trimiprosate is also the same mechanism where
but
you inhibit the...
But it is targeting amyloid plaque, I am asking for monoclonal antibody. MAB. It's in the pipeline and it is targeting amyloid plaque. Okay, I can give it to you, 20 marks for that. It's also in pipeline. Okay, last drug. Name the recently approved drug for by FDA to treat psychosis in Parkinson patient, which acts by 5-HT2A inverse agonist mechanism, 25 marks. Where you have read about that drug, on the same page this drug is given. Make a guess, any new drug? Okay, what the answers I was expecting? No, it's pimavanserin. Agomelatin is the antidepressant on melatonin receptor. Melatonin receptor, we know two drugs, Amiltion and Agomelatin. Agomelatin is primarily for depression. Clozapine is the only antipsychotic which is useful in the treatment of tardive dyskinesia. Rotigotine, you answered correct. I was expecting bapenezumab, solanezumab, crenezumab. Remember these three names. Okay? And pimavanserin. So, they are given 15 plus 20. Last team.
Sir, tardive dyskinesia. Clozapine is useful in treatment or it's the lowest effect?
It can be useful in the treatment as well because it has results reported of decreasing tardive dyskinesia. Only drug. So you don't have a choice. So the only theme left for you, I don't know why neurophysiology is left. Let's see whether, what would you have chosen if you would have been given first choice? Anything other than neuromedicine? Okay, neurophysiology. Declarative memory is the function of which part of the brain? Precisely. Declarative memory. You know what is declarative memory?
Frontal lobe?
No, it's not frontal lobe. In NREM sleep, which neurotransmitter is increased?
Orexin?
No, I cannot give it to you. Name the nucleus associated with drug addiction. Very famous. Some tract. Some pathway, some nucleus, anything.
Pape circuit, the limbic,
no,
amygdala.
No. Pape circuit is not correct. Okay. Increased neural activity before skilled voluntary movement is seen in which part of the brain? Two parts. Any of the two you can name. Increased neural activity before skilled voluntary movement is seen in which part? Reference from Ganong.
Basal ganglia is one of them.
Yes, basal ganglia is the correct answer. 20 marks. Last question. Which area in brain is primary motor area for shivering?
Hypothalamus.
Which part?
Hypothalamus. Two big hands.
Posterior hypothalamus.
Which part of the posterior? Posterior hypothalamus has so many nucleus. Posterior hypothalamus is okay, but I cannot give it 25 marks for it. It's dorsomedial posterior hypothalamus. Shivering. Medial temporal lobe. Declarative memory, medial temporal lobe, not frontal lobe. Frontal lobe is working memory. That is dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. GABA. GABA is NREM, acetylcholine REM. Nucleus accumbens, reward pathway, mesolimbic circuit. From ventral tegmental area to the nucleus accumbens. Dopamine. Cerebellum and basal ganglia both are the correct answers. And you can be given 20 for this round. Okay. So this was our theme round. So after this, we have round number 6, rapid fire round. Before round number 6, can we have the scores? For round number 6, I'd like to invite Sumer sir.
End of this round, the scores are, we have, I think, 90. So we have team A at 95, team B 195, team C 135, team D at 65, team E at 80. So there is still two rounds left. Now we'll do a very quick rapid fire round, and after that we have a round on ECG, which has never been done in a quiz, but it will. Both of the rounds will be high scoring round. There is a potential that you can actually make or break the fortune in these two rounds. Okay, so are we going to project the questions? Now in this round, each team will be given a set of 10 questions in succession to be answered in 1 minute. We'll go in clockwise direction from A to E. Every correct answer, there is 5 marks, no negative marking. If you don't want to answer, you can say pass. If time remains, we will come back to the question in the end. Okay? And okay, let's, I think everything else is clear. Team A. Team A, are you ready for your rapid fire round now? Okay. Team A. Okay. Type of amyloid systemic senile amyloidosis is? Correct. Lineage specific marker for myeloid series is? Increased risk of which infection is seen in hairy cell leukemia? Tumor marker for choriocarcinoma? Correct. Which antibody isotope is called as agglutinating antibody? Correct. Immune complex mediated disease is which type of hypersensitivity reaction?
Type 3.
Correct. Which parasite is known as grand old man of intestine? Correct. Premature closure of coronal suture give rise to? Wrong. Ashley's rule helps to identify? Correct. Non-invasive technique of autopsy is known as? Okay. So which questions did you did not answer? You did not answer the question number 2. We have a linear specific marker. We don't have that as the answer. Any other answer you want to give, or are we over with the time? Anything else you want to? No, we don't have that answer. No. Anything else you want to do in your time left? Okay. Okay. Now we're done with this. So how many? They got 6 right. You got 6 right. Very good for a rapid fire. And the correct answers were in the question number 2 for myeloid series of myeloperoxidase, and the infection in hairy cell leukemia is atypical mycobacterium, and I think everything else you got correctly. Brachycephaly was the coronal suture, if there is premature closure of the coronal suture. Okay, and the non-invasive technique was virtual autopsy, you could actually have done it. So, but you got 6, which is very good. Okay, team B, are you ready for your direct rapid fire team B? Okay. Let me start now. Knockdown technology employs which RNA?
siRNA or miRNA.
Correct. First gene to be knocked out in colorectal carcinoma?
APC.
Correct. Antigen common to both alveolar and glomerular basement membrane in type 4 collagen?
Pass.
Which testicular tumor is positive for CD30?
Seminoma.
CD30.
Seminoma.
Incorrect. Pathognomic feature of Entamoeba histolytica?
kinetoplast. Kinetoplast.
Okay. We go to next question. Wrong. I don't have that as the answer. Which family of the virus has non-functional ribosomes?
Pass.
Most common cause of infantile
rotavirus.
Lining. Correct. Oath is defined under which section of IPC?
Pass.
Kevorkian sign is seen in?
Pass.
Swallow tails seen in? Okay.
Huntington's.
Okay, the time is up. Now, this time is up. So, the answers that we have are knockdown technology employs siRNA, which is correct. Colorectal cancer APC, you answered it correctly. Alpha 3 is the antigen common to both alveolar and glomerular basement membrane. CD30 was embryonal carcinoma. Erythrophagosis, hemophagocytes was the answer we were looking for. Arena viridae was the family of virus with non-functional ribosomes. Section 51 IPC was for oath. And swallowtails are seen in lacerated wounds. So how many did they get correct? Three. You got three correct in this round. Three. Team C. Okay. On your marks now. Fatty change in the heart resembling an animal is called as. Pearl stain is used for detecting. Correct. Pan B cell marker is. Incorrect. Endothelial cell marker is. Wrong. Causative agent for bacillary angiomatosis is. Struvite stones are produced by which bacterium? Yes. Correct. Gene associated with MRSA. Okay, we give it to you. Correct. Which type of tremors are seen in chronic mercury poisoning? What types? You want to know the name. We want to type of type, not the name. Type. Course. Correct. Body stippling is seen in. Body stippling is seen in. Okay. Paradoxical undressing is seen in. Wrong. Paradoxical undressing is seen in. Okay. So the correct answers are Tiger effect. Pearl stain was iron that we saw in the question also when we were looking at hemochromatosis. Pan B cell marker is CD19. Endothelial cell marker is CD31. Bacillary angiomatosis is Bartonella. And Proteus, you got it correct. Coarse and intestinal tremors in chronic mercury, you got correct. Body stippling is bomb blast. And paradoxical undressing is hypothermia. Okay. So team 4, are you ready for your direct questions now? Rapid fire, team 4. Incidence of which thyroid cancer increases after radiation?
Capillary.
Correct. Exposure to which drug causes fibrin ring granuloma formation in the liver?
Pass.
Initiator caspase in humans?
8 and 10.
Correct. Pregnant uterus predominantly shows which cellular adaptation?
Hypertrophy.
Correct. Microchorridia are absent in which dermatophyte?
Microsporum.
Incorrect. Broad-based budding yeast cells are seen in?
Blastomyces.
Correct. Capsule in Haemophilus influenza type B is made up of?
Polysaccharide.
PRP.
Correct. Cause of death in cafe coronary is?
Asphyxia. Choking asphyxia. Okay, next question.
Okay, we're incorrect. Drug which increases uterine contractions are called
oxytocin.
Known as?
Oxytocin.
We don't have that. Section 376D of IPC deals with? So, let's see the correct answers. Papillary cancer, thyroid, you have gotten correctly. The drug which causes fibrin ring granuloma in the liver is allopurinol. Initiator caspase is caspase 10. Microconidia are absent in epidermophyton. Pregnant uterus shows hypertrophy, you have got it correct. Cause of death in coronary is cardiac arrest. Drug which increases uterine contractions are Ecbolex. And 376D of IPC deals with gangrene. Okay. Team E. They got 5 correct. 5 correct. That's which is actually good.
Oxytocin or oxytocin can be called as.
We can give you that. We can one more. 6 is what you get. 6. Okay. Team 5. Questions for you. Azopardy effect is seen in?
Carcinoid.
Incorrect. Risk of which cancer increases in daughters or mother exposes to DES? Incorrect. Which small cell vasculitis presents with tinnitus?
Vaginous.
Correct. Which trinucleide is repeated in Fragile X syndrome?
CGG.
Incorrect. Gold standard for diagnosis of helicobacterial pylori infection is? Incorrect. Urinary antigen detection is available for which species and serotype of Legionella? Bruri ulcer is caused by?
Mycobacterium? Ulcerous.
Correct. Which metallic poison gives rise to Anguru syndrome?
Don't know.
Which metallic poison?
Don't know. Pass.
Rolling injuries are seen in which type of vehicles? Which type of vehicles? Okay. So it was actually vehicle with low chassis. And the question that you could not deck was, what is the first internal sign of putrefaction? That is reddish brown discoloration of intima of the aorta. And the questions that you have gotten wrong are, azopardy effect is seen in small cell cancer. Risk of cancer in daughters or mothers exposed to DES is clear cell adenocarcinoma. Vasculitis with tinnitus is vaginous, which you got correctly. Fragile X syndrome, it is CGG. And gold standard for H. pylori is culture. Okay.
Sir,
so
is the gold standard not rapid urease on biopsy?
We said gold standard. So, and it gives me great pride to now announce the final scores of this quiz. And any guesses which is winning? Let's see. Let's see. So my goal in this quiz is, I hope you appreciate that we have, you have all attended many lectures and many didactic lectures, but I want you to know that learning can also be made fun by activities like quizzing. And that is my purpose of inviting you all here today, is to make sure that you understand the value of quizzing in medical education. And my goal is to make sure that you understand that we can actually learn by playing, and there are no losers, okay? Although there would be some team which is going to win today, some is going to lose, but there's no loser. Everybody learns. At least you have come all the way to represent your zone to Delhi, and I think all the teams deserve a big hand. And I also feel that all the audience also deserve a bigger hand for their active participation. And finally, I will ask you to, you know, clap once more for the team which is, you know, manage the timing, and the IT team, they've all been working. 2nd October was a holiday for everybody, but my team was here working for the entire day yesterday, despite it being their holiday, and they were working to fit all the cameras and everything in place. Now, with this note and a note of appreciation, I'd like to now thank all the faculty members who have contributed to the quiz, and they have actually been, you know, working around in, despite their clinical schedules, they have helped us in making. And I especially would like to mention Deepthi here, and Arvind, Sachin, and Siddharth. Especially Arvind, because he brought in a new idea in place. He came in, he came in today and said, I want to do ECG quiz. And he added a new round in the quiz, I told the participant also. So with this, we finally, I'm going to announce the team, team which has come last today. Don't, you know, take it to heart, but you have learned something by coming here today. Team 5, team from South Zone. Team from South Zone is today the last team for the day. So, do we have any prizes for them? No. But we can still give them a round of applause. And from my side, I can give them my book, Fire in the Belly. Maybe that might encourage them for their further preparation. I ask you to come forward, all the teams one by one, okay? Team 5, please come forward. Team D. And the next we have, okay. And the next team is team from East Zone. Team from East Zone is today at number 4. Please come forward.
You played well, you played well, but it is all about the better team which wins on the day. And the team which has come third today is team from West Zone, team from Mumbai. Please come forward. You are today at number three. We have cash prizes for all top three teams. So please, number three, please come. Come forward. Team from West Zone, team from Mumbai. Congratulations. And team which has come second today is the team which was added as a wild card entry today. Team from Maulana Azad Medical College. Team, congratulations. There is a cash prize to be won for you as well. Congratulations. My own college. Congratulations. And we have the winner is no surprise to anybody because they were the one of them, the team members was a winner of our last Grey Matter quiz as well. So I invite team from AIIMS. Dr. Pang, Dr. Ria, please come forward and claim your prize. The winner takes home 50,000 rupees is the prize. Congratulations. Well done. So I hope you enjoyed the experience with the quizzing. And I hope everybody listening to us on YouTube and Facebook enjoyed this experience. And
right, so I was just saying till we're giving the award-giving ceremony, maybe we could have a few words from all the people who have attended the quiz as well about how your experience was and, you know, and what we can do to make it more interesting next time maybe as well, right? So let's start from the winning team. So Umang is here and he's going to tell us how his experience was.
Hello. So I came here last year as well with my senior Shubham Agarwal, and that year I thought that it was all because of that we won, and I was just like an add-on. But today I had a great partner with me, Ria, and we had a good time, and it was a good quiz, and we had good competition, and I met people that I've met before. Charlene is here, and it's good to meet friends, and it's good to compete with them. It's fun, and this was a very well thought out quiz. I've attended Arvind Sir's ECG quiz and UCMS before, so very entertaining and very it increased my knowledge. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
So maybe we, no, Ria doesn't want to come up. All right, maybe Shireen can come up and tell us how his experience was.
Okay, this was a learning experience for me. Actually, I'm myself a quiz master. I've been organizing quizzes in my college. So thank you, ma'am and sir. This has been a learning experience for me, and it was a great quiz which you organized. And maybe if we would have prepared better, you know,
we yeah. Next time as well, yes. Right? Great. Why don't you guys come up as well? So how was your experience being here?
It was a great experience. Actually, we were able to incorporate many new points, and our knowledge got refreshed. Hard to accept the fact that we just lost by a very narrow margin. So you know. Hard to digest, but still it was a new experience to come here. We are actually, we were told by Ayush sir today that we are the first team from MC to come for the Grey Matter. So I think our juniors and will come in the future, and they may definitely win the TAMS.
Definitely. Look forward to it.
This is a great quiz. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Alright, all the best guys. Very, very well done. And all right. So how was the experience for the audience there? Did you enjoy it? Do you want to be on the other side as well? Right. So prepare yourself. There we hold the quiz every year, and we wish to see many more of you, you know, coming up for these kind of sessions. And as Sumesa said, it is always, you know, there are different ways of learning. It doesn't have to be one single way to make it more interesting. So if you have ideas how we can make it more interesting, you're more than welcome as well to give us the ideas, and work up to come on the other side of the table as well, right? Thank you so much to all the audience. You're really very kind and very, very supportive as well. So thank you so very much, right?